Okay, car dealers are debuting their 2021 models, and some of them, they're pretty impressive, to say the least. Heather Lake, live in La Jolla this morning with a look at one of the fastest on the market. This is more what we, let's call this our dream vehicle, not the most practical thing you've ever seen. Yeah. Hi, Heather.
Yeah, Rebel, I'm going to do my, here you go, Price is Right. So, do you want to be the announcer?
Oh, my
the
God.
The 2021 McLaren could all be yours. Yeah. I know, just take a look. I don't even need to say anything. We just need silence, maybe a little music, I don't know. This is a beauty. Oh my goodness. So the folks here at Ogara, they basically called us up and said, hey, you gotta take a look at this car. Just came in, this is the 2021 model. Not even the first production car, right? So Montana, tell us a little bit about this. When you look at the serial number on the inside, it says 000. So it's not even actually the first car made. What does that mean?
It's a pre-production car strictly for marketing, for showing all the people around the country the new 765 LT. It's an evolved version of the 720S, which was the last hypercar that they produced. It's lighter, faster, looks way better, and it's limited at 765 global production.
Have you driven it?
I haven't driven it yet, no.
Okay, but this, you can drive this car. Yeah, you can drive it. Should you drive it is the question,
probably
right?
Probably not.
Okay, it is street legal when it's made.
Yes.
So you can actually pre-order it right now. So people are actually ordering this car.
Yeah,
to
so
have
we've
in their garage.
Yeah, we've sold out of about all of our allocation for the year.
What?
Yes.
What?
Yeah,
already?
Before the car is even produced, yes.
That's insane. Okay, I want to learn. I guess if you don't know how to open the doors, you probably can't afford it. my thoughts. You showed me how, if I can just remember. So it's somewhere
right
here.
Right, there's a little pad.
Right here.
Pull up on it.
Okay, hold on. There we go.
There you go.
Whoa. So how fast will this car go? Is this the fastest McLaren ever made yet?
It's not the fastest top speed McLaren's made.
Okay.
It gets to 205 miles an hour, but the rate that it can get up to that is one of the quickest McLaren has produced for street legal vehicles.
Yes. Okay, so 205 miles per hour, it is street legal. What makes this one so unique?
It's a limited production vehicle. I mean, all McLarens have full carbon fiber chassis to begin with, but this one, they made an already incredible supercar even better. So
wow.
The 720 that was before this, already amazing, super light, super quick. This can be up to 200 pounds lighter. It's got 45 more horsepower. It's wider, it's lower, way more aggressive aerodynamics. You look at all the carbon on the outside. It's just, it's a street legal race car.
Listen, I'm just thinking, you know, Zach and I, we travel around quite a bit, my photographer, and we need a car that we'll look really good in to get around San Diego every day. So when you're ready, we're ready to have this as our, you know, getaway vehicle for our morning news segments, Rebel. What do you think?
I'm in love.
I'm just saying,
with that
like
car.
Zach and I, we've been a team for a long time.
Wow.
I think we deserve this. I'm gonna get in here. We'll see how I fit. I think it's pretty cozy.
Are we allowed to ask the price, or is it one of those if you have to ask?
It looks pretty good getting around town in this.
Just put a Fox 5 sticker on it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why not?
Just need a couple of Fox 5 decals. You guys want to know how much it cost?
Yes.
You want to know?
Yes. Yes.
Montana?
So base price is $358,000 for a standard vehicle.
What?
The way this one's equipped is probably in the 470, 480 range.
470, 480, 470, 480.
I was thinking of the Bugatti.
Chrissy says that's nothing.
So I'll take
Wait,
two.
Can you try to
sure,
negotiate
we'll
and see if he'll go back to his manager and see what he comes back with? To see. Mike.
Let's negotiate, Montana. I'll trade in my 2019 Chevy Astro van for one of these.
I don't know about that. Don't they have those giant windows over there? Can they open them up and rev that thing up a little bit for? We can't start it in there? Come on. They have big windows.
Yeah.
Come on now. I want to hear it. Can we hear the
engine?
Yeah. No? Heather, thank you. I don't think we're going to get Heather out of that car. That's what I know. Okay, bye. Wow, well, that color, right? It's like a... Yeah, everybody's like, yeah, no kidding. It's like, get that car or get a house.
I was thinking of the Bugatti.
Yeah, the Bugatti costs millions. Yeah. Outdoor performances and plenty of social distancing at the CMT Awards. Fox's Ashley Dvorkin with a look at the big winners in country music.
country music fans picked their faves for the 2020 CMT Music Awards. The stars accepted those honors with a night of big thank yous and performances for an audience at home and the show's social distanced viewing party in Nashville.
We are not just all over Music City.
Ashley McBride, Kane Brown, and Sarah Hyland took on hosting duties. Ashley and Kane also performed. Didn't seem to mind. Stages were set up in Music City and throughout Middle Tennessee for artists, including Maren Morris, Dan and Shay, Mickey Guyton, and Little Big Town. Katy Perry introduced her friend Luke Bryan, and Jessica Chastain introduced Shania Twain performing from Switzerland. Collaborations included Luke Combs and Brooks and Dunn, Jimmy Allen and Noah Cyrus, and Kelsey Ballerini and Halsey.
I feel so loved this evening.
Of the entirely fan-voted awards, Carrie Underwood won the coveted Video of the Year and Female Video of the Year for Drinking Alone. Underwood is the most awarded artist in the show's history. Her total is now 22. Palm trees lean. Luke Bryan won Male Video of the Year, Dan and Shay took Duo, and Old Dominion won Group.
I Hope by Gabby Barrett.
Superstar Taylor Swift presented Gabby Barrett with Breakthrough Video of the Year. In special honors, Jennifer Nettles received the inaugural Equal Play Award for her work for gender parity and diversity in country music.
It's my sisters out there who continue to burn the holy fire.
And prior to the show, Granger Smith was awarded the added category of Quarantine Video of the Year. In Hollywood, Ashley Dvorkin, Fox News.
Time now for your Fox 5 Surf Report, sponsored by Jerome's Furniture, Southern California's hometown furniture store.
And the surf today is mixed. It's a mixed swell at 1 to 3 feet with some 4-foot sets coming in. Low tide at 7:33, so we're just about at low tide now. By the way, it's 6:49 if you're wondering. And high tide at just before 2 o'clock this afternoon at a 5.0. 64 to 70 degree water temperature. Okay, so we take a live look here from the HD on Tap camera network. And here's Del Mar, and that's Dog Beach, and we're just about getting to low tide as we speak. Cold air mass getting from Montana, Wyoming, the Dakotas. Now, red flag warnings in the Four Corners, rain in Miami, and a hurricane tropical system there out in the Atlantic. All right, so cooler weather is happening. It will cool down even more today, and before you know it, we'll have temperatures 5-10 degrees below average for this time of the year. We could also have some showers, but it's cloudy. We'll have a partly cloudy day today with lower temperatures compared to yesterday. Right now, though, it is warmer compared to yesterday because we have more cloud coverage. We have about a 3,000 feet deep marine layer this morning. It got up to 74 degrees yesterday downtown San Diego. You can expect low 70s, even upper 60s today. 6:59 is when the sun will come up, and it'll set tonight at 6:07. Now, the chance of rain this weekend. Saturday, you'll be fine. Even Sunday, you'll be fine, really. If you don't mind like a tenth of an inch of rain or so. I mean, no lightning or anything associated with this, so should be safe, just depending on the circumstances. We get into early Monday morning, and then we get into Monday afternoon, into Tuesday, and we see a lot more rain showing up on the forecast here. The blue color contour is indicating half an inch to an inch and a half of rain. The green is less than a half of an inch. With that being said, the models are not in great agreement. Even this run, which has been pretty consistent, it was showing the same thing yesterday, which is good. You know, the consistency, you get a little more confidence in it, but just between me and you, I got my eye on that. We'll see if that happens. Okay, so low 70s today, tomorrow and the next, upper 60s, Sunday, Monday with rain. And then we're warming up with Santa Ana's next week. Inland valleys, mid 70s today, tomorrow the next, upper 60s on Sunday, then close to 80 there on Wednesday. All right, southbound on the 15 at Via Rancho Parkway. Watch out for a crash, unknown injuries. And the Sharp Mary Birch camera showing traffic heavy getting over to the hospitals. Give it people getting to work this morning. And again, just that southbound 15, 94 eastbound at Lemon Grove doesn't seem to be a huge problem. And a crash there again, and some debris in the lanes on the southbound 15 of Via Rancho. Shali, over to you.
Chrissy, thank you. UC San Diego celebrating homecoming all week. More than 20 virtual events are taking place. That includes a 24th annual Triton 5K this Sunday. You can walk, run, or even bike your miles anywhere. The money raised goes to student scholarships. To register, go to the Fox Eye San Diego website and click on the Scene On tab. Coming up, the CDC updating its guidelines for contact with other people during the pandemic, how it could lead to more contact tracing. And a good morning to Mark and Jeannie from Poway. You are the Fox 5 Friend of the Day, Friends of the Day, presented by Jerome's. They like being in love for 26 years and playing golf. If you want to be our Friend of the Day, head to our website. You could win a gift card to Jerome's Furniture, where all showrooms are now open. We got the coronavirus vaccine trial back underway even after a volunteer died. Plus, what an antitrust lawsuit against Google means for the future of big tech companies. And Eric Richards.
Good morning to you. Good morning, everyone. Election officials taking the utmost precaution when it comes to voting in person. The changes next.
Right now at 7 o'clock, keeping local voters healthy. The guidelines in place to make sure everyone in San Diego can safely cast their ballot.
Then the FBI sounds the alarm about election interference, the threatening emails sent to some voters.
And the moment a strip mall goes up in flames and it's all caught on camera.
Plus, why police say the Southern California mom missing for nearly 2 weeks in Utah may not be telling the truth. The Fox 5 Morning News at 7 starts right now.
Live from San Diego, this is the Fox 5 Morning News at 7.
Good morning and thanks for joining us all. We appreciate it. It's Thursday, October 22nd. I'm Raul Martinez.
And I'm Shalali Zamarodi. How about we get your day started with Chrissy Russo? She has your instant weather and traffic for you. Chrissy, good morning.
Good morning. The sun is up. It is Thursday. It is cloudy, and this is the SDG&E cams, Boucher Hill, the east camera, and that's the marine layer in about 3,000 feet deep, and the sun is up, pretty colors in the sky. It is a gorgeous morning on top of the clouds, and down below the clouds, it is overcast. 69 degrees downtown San Diego, southwest winds at 5 miles per hour. That's a coastal eddy, and that means more clouds before we have less. We're going to have a partly cloudy day today. Low 70s at the coast and mid to low 70s inland. Way awesome day on the way. Like super awesome day on the way. Even along the coastline, some of the coastal communities might not even get out of the 60s today. Okay, a crash here southbound on the 15 right there via Rancho Parkway. You're backed up from the 78 on that one. Shelly and Raul, back over to you.
All right, Chrissy, thank you. New this morning, the Senate Judiciary Committee advances President Trump's Supreme Court nominee, Judge Amy Coney Barrett, to the full Senate for a confirmation vote. Democrats boycotted, but lacked the votes needed to block the move by Republicans. In their place, Democrats put cardboard cutouts and pictures of people affected by the Affordable Care Act. The full Senate will now take up her nomination. A final vote could take place on Monday, just 8 days before the election.
And with less than 2 weeks away from the election, more than 560,000 voters have already cast their ballots. Fox 5's Eric Richards joining us live now to explain the safety measures for people voting in person. Eric, good morning.
Yeah, hey, good morning, Raul. Good morning to everyone waking up. You know, talking with County Registrar Michael Vu, he says he does expect a record turnout when it comes to this election compared to what we saw in the 2016 election. Also, even though we know things have dramatically changed because of COVID, I mean, they are still ramping up efforts to get people to come out here and vote in person if you feel safe. Listen to some of the changes, though, they've made, according to Michael Vu.
Voters have been informed that there are going to be less physical sites than there has been in the past. We were anticipating that there would be 1,600 precincts, but due to the pandemic and to the response to the pandemic, we are now consolidating those respective locations into much larger facilities that allow social distancing over a four-day period as opposed to a one-day period on top of sending everyone a mail ballot.
So County Registrar Michael Vu has been relentless in creating a safe voting environment for the countless nearly 2 million registered voters. Now we're told every voter received a ballot on October 5th, even though those who have not requested one. It was announced yesterday nearly a quarter of those have already been processed. Good news there. Now Vu says his office is working with public health services to ensure the health and safety of election workers, also voters. He says his office is bringing in nearly 3,600 poll workers, which will be getting their temperature checks daily, as well as being screened for those COVID symptoms. Election officials also say before a voter enters a polling area, they will have to sanitize their hands. And once inside, they'll be greeted by 7 check-in stations, all of which have gone through various disinfecting protocols. Back at Live this morning outside headquarters here, we're talking Registrar of Voters. If you do not feel comfortable voting in person, keep in mind, folks, that there are about 126 drop-off locations across the county. We're live in Kearny Mesa. We'll get it back to you.
Got it. Eric Richards, thank you for that.
County leaders continue to urge people to follow health measures as COVID case rates remain at the state limit for the red tier. There are some concerns that the county could move backwards and then face more shutdowns.
We dodged a bullet as it related to the tiered structure. We could not have gotten any closer to the purple tier. Because we've been testing above the state average, the state adjustment factor has allowed us to stay in the red tier.
San Diego County reported 263 new coronavirus cases yesterday. 6 deaths were also reported, as well as 6 new community outbreaks. There have been more than 48,000 recoveries.
The CDC is now redefining what counts as close contact with someone who has COVID-19. For months now, health officials said close contact was spending 15 minutes within 6 feet of someone who tested positive. Well, now they describe it as a total of 15 minutes or more. So shorter but repeated contacts add up to a 15 minutes over a 24-hour period. Got that? The change may prompt health departments to do contact tracing in cases where an exposure might not have been considered close. AstraZeneca's COVID-19 vaccine, meantime, the trial will continue despite the death of one of the volunteers taking part. According to the company and their partner, the person who died was given the placebo in Brazil and not the actual vaccine. Regulators in Brazil determined the drug and the vaccine were safe. Several trials of that vaccine had to be halted worldwide when some of the volunteers got sick. The trial remains on hold here in the U.S.
A 28-year-old woman arrested for murder in Chula Vista. Vanessa Gastillo is accused of shooting and killing 23-year-old Christina Garcia. Police found Garcia's body in a field behind a store on Main Street back in August. Investigators are still looking into what led up to that shooting.
A 19-hour standoff ends with police arresting a man on a roof in City Heights. Officers went to a domestic dispute on Wilson Avenue yesterday morning. A woman claims the father of her child broke into the home and got into a fight. A police helicopter spotted the man running in backyards and then climbed on top of a roof on 35th Street, where he stayed for hours. Police blocked off some areas and they called in the negotiators.
Tried talking to him, and he was on the rooftop hiding. And then they blockaded like the area off and all that. And then I went to work, and I got home and everything was still going on. And they were like, oh, he's just on the rooftop still, just sitting up there. And he's literally been sitting there, walking around, pacing himself, tearing up the vents, all of that.
Investigators say the man arrested appeared to be under the influence.
Border Patrol agents in El Centro make 2 major drug busts in a matter of hours. The first one happened on Tuesday morning. Agents stopped a car and then found more than a pound of fentanyl hidden under the rear passenger seat. And then about 5 hours later, a dog alerted agents to a second car. Inside, they found nearly 16 pounds of meth stashed under the hood of the car. Both drivers were taken into custody.
Investigators in Utah now questioning exactly what happened to a Southern California mom lost in Zion National Park for nearly 2 weeks. Authorities say her story just is not quite adding up. The 38-year-old disappeared in the park earlier this month, and she was found 12 days later. She told her family that she stayed close to water and hit her head while hiking. However, investigators say she had no visible head injuries, and much of the drinking water in Zion is actually full of parasites. Her disappearance remains under investigation.
Highly sought after testimony from Ghislaine Maxwell is released. A New York judge released Maxwell's deposition this morning after a court ruled against her bid to keep it secret. This testimony comes from a 2016 defamation case involving Jeffrey Epstein accuser. It reportedly contains details about Maxwell's relationship with Epstein. She is currently being held without bail in New York, now awaiting trial over charges related to Epstein's sexual crimes.
Happening tonight, the final debate between President Trump and former Vice President Joe Biden. This time, the candidate not talking can be muted. That means each debater will get 2 minutes to talk without interruption during opening statements on each topic. The president called that mute button unfair while talking to reporters yesterday, but he is still planning to attend.
One topic likely to come up tonight, election interference. As Jeff Paul reports, the FBI says Iran and Russia may be trying to influence and even threaten voters.
Intelligence officials confirming foreign interference in the 2020 presidential election. Authorities say Iranian and Russian agents have stolen voter registration information, and the sabotage is already underway.
We have already seen Iran sending spoofed emails designed to intimidate voters.
Those same officials calling these attacks desperate attempts by desperate adversaries.
Iran is distributing other content to include a video that implies that individuals could cast fraudulent ballots, even from overseas.
Russia's intentions remain more secretive, but authorities are on heightened alert.
We are aware that they have obtained some voter information, just as they did in 2016. Rest assured that we are prepared.
Authorities say these actions will not be tolerated, and plans to squash any interference are in motion.
We're also coordinating with the private sectors to make sure that their platforms aren't used by foreign adversaries to spread disinformation.
Intelligence personnel say election security is not a partisan issue, adding everyone should trust in our democracy.
If you receive an intimidating or manipulative email in your inbox, don't be alarmed and do not spread it.
You should be confident that your vote counts.
President Trump has instructed the Director of National Intelligence to update the public on any further interference with full transparency. Jeff Paul, Fox News.
Florida voters are concerned over potential voting intimidation at the polls. Police in Tampa say that there were armed guards at a polling place there. Now, those men said that they were hired by the president's campaign. The supervisor of elections there says that she immediately took action after hearing about it.
There were persons dressed in what looked like security guard uniform and maybe had sidearms, so firearms on their hip. So we executed our plan. We contacted our points of contact within the sheriff's office, who then immediately responded to this situation.
The Trump campaign said the men had no ties to them. It is illegal in Florida to bring a gun to a polling place.
A court sides with the California GOP over ballot drop boxes. As Fox 5's Ashley Zavala explains, the party won't have to hand over voter information of those who use them.
A Sacramento Superior Court judge Wednesday sided with the California Republican Party, ruling it does not have to hand over the names and addresses of voters who use GOP-sponsored ballot boxes.
It will be a whole day in hell before the Republican Party voluntarily hands over to the Secretary of State the names of voters who entrusted their ballots to us. We believe they're entitled to privacy. We do intend to respond formally in writing to the discovery requests that were propounded on us, but they may not be able to get all the information that they want. But for now, it's round one that went to us.
Wednesday's decision comes a day after the state's Democratic Attorney General and Secretary of State sued the California GOP. Through the lawsuit, the two are attempting to get the party to comply with an investigation into unauthorized ballot drop boxes. A spokesperson for the Attorney General said Wednesday it continues to review the matter and will continue to take steps, including in court where necessary, to ensure every voter who cast their ballot will have their voices heard. The battle over the ballot boxes is now into its second week after members of the Republican Party set up some drop boxes in GOP offices and near gun shops and churches. State Democratic leaders claim the boxes are illegal, while Republicans remain confident they are in line with state ballot collection laws. How many boxes and their exact location, the GOP won't say. In Sacramento, Ashley Zavala, Fox 5 News.
And don't forget, you could check out our Fox 5 San Diego Voters Guide. You can get a rundown of all the races, all the measures on our ballot. Just click on the election tab at fox5sandiego.com.
Time now for your morning weather, sponsored by Jerome's Furniture.
All right, Chrissy Russo standing by with your forecast. There was rain and no rain for this weekend, which makes me very excited. I mean, we want the rain, but still.
Sorry, what?
What?
One more time.
You said there was rain, and then now there's not going to be as much rain, which made me very excited, because I'm doing pumpkin carving outside this weekend.
Okay, which day this weekend?
Sunday.
That'll be fine. You might get a little rained on, but, you know, a tenth of an inch or so.
Okay.
You know, it won't be totally dry. But it's Monday is the day that it's looking like we could get the heavier rain.
They got pushed back a little bit.
Like real rain? Like get your jacket and umbrella and your rain boots out?
But yes, the answer is, well, I don't know if you need your galoshes for like, well, it could be, you know, I'll show you this. I'll show it to you. You'll see the color contour of all the blues that are indicating, you know, the accumulation of anywhere between a half an inch and an inch and a half of rain in San Diego County. Now, the models are not in great agreement, so I say this with trepidation. You know what? Tomorrow could be a whole different story because that was the deal 2 days ago. So this has been the last 2 days have been about the same. So the confidence is starting to get a little higher. I'll keep you posted, of course. Cooling trend, cooler day today, less fog, but more clouds. Marine layer is about 3,000 feet deep. weekend showers, especially into Sunday, Monday. Monday, the big day. Santa Ana's then after that. Yesterday's high temperature downtown San Diego was 74 degrees, 2 degrees above normal. We're still above normal temperatures, but today we should hit that normal average should be kind of weather. 6:59 is when the sun came up. It'll set tonight at 6:07. And nationally, you know, we've got this tropical system out in the Atlantic. We've got some rain in Chicago, some snow in Billings in the Twin Cities areas, record-breaking amount of snow, over a foot in many areas. Low clouds for us. It's a coastal eddy. It's a southwest wind driving in a 3,000 feet deep marine layer, and that's got us all socked in. We'll have a better look at that when the visible satellite is visible. Getting up into Redding under a freeze warning until 8 o'clock this morning, and the low temperatures certainly below freezing. Red flag warning still in San Francisco. El Cajon, you have 5 miles visibility. Temperatures right now, 55 degrees Alpine. Wow. 62 degrees Poway, 63 degrees Escondido. Dew point temperatures are perfect. I mean, perfect. So it's really comfortable humidity-wise. All right, so here's the 10-day outlook, the rain forecast. We get into 8 o'clock in the morning on Sunday. So Saturday night, we've got some sprinkles and that could register on the rain gauges. So, you know, do you want to wash your car? Do you want to use the sprinkles to wash your car? That kind of thing. We get in through the day on Sunday. And on Sunday, about a tenth of an inch, maybe 0.2 inch of rainfall. That's measurable stuff. I mean, it's not a huge amount, but it's something. Then we get into Monday afternoon, late morning, afternoon, and that's when some much heavier rain could fall. Now, keeping in mind, the blue is what is indicating the half an inch to an inch and a half. That is possible. The green is less than a half an inch. So we've got the color contour showing us quite a bit there. But check this out, and then I'll show you the 7-day. Our future scan, look at that. We get into Monday in the morning, and look at that snow forecast. There's snow in this one. Could we get a flurry in San Diego County mountains? Not likely, but if we were, it would be Palomar, and it would be for just a New York minute. All right, here's a look at that 7-day forecast at the beach. We're looking at low 70s today, tomorrow, and the next. Upper 60s Sunday, Monday with some showers. And then Santa Ana's kick in mid-70s as we get into Wednesday. Inland Valley's mid-70s today, upper 60s on Sunday. Now we're looking at 70 on Monday and close to 80 there on Wednesday. All right, let's take a look. Sharp Mary Birch camera, you see the low clouds and traffic seems to be moving along fine there. The 54 going westbound at the 805, watch out for a crash. The southbound 15 at Via Rancho Parkway turns out is a multi-vehicle crash. It's a big, pretty big pile up there and you're backed up from the 78 coming in hot on that one. All right, that wraps it up for us live from the world famous Mega Map on the Hamel Casino back lot. Now back inside with you.
Okay, Chrissy, thank you. The Justice Department accused Google of illegally protecting its monopoly in online searches and the advertising, the all-important advertising. Attorney Wendy Patrick explains what this could mean for our future online searches. Wendy, good morning.
Good morning, Raul.
Well, Google has become almost like it's a verb now. You Google something. That means that they have attained quite a chunk of the marketplace.
Well, that's right, Raul, and that's the problem. It's a noun, it's a verb, and we always say, if you don't believe us, just Google it. It's so easy.
Right.
But did you ever stop to think why, in fact, that's the search engine that comes up? No matter what browser you open, it's probably not going to default to Yahoo or Bing. It's going to default to Google. And that's part of the lawsuit, is it has really achieved a monopoly. Now, it's kind of a bittersweet announcement for many Americans that rely on Google for everything. And we think to ourselves, we don't even know how to use other search engines. I mean, how do they work? What kinds of things? Do they have a Maps function and a Google Earth function, the same types of ways in which we've enjoyed using Google for so many years? But basically, the Justice Department says, you know what? This is bad for competition. And in the long run, that's going to be bad for consumers. We can't have a monopoly because capitalism requires competition. That's the gist.
But isn't there a little bit of irony in the fact that, wham, Bing is crying about it? Bing is Microsoft. Come on, speaking of monopolies, I mean, it's not like it's a little rinky-dinky mom and pop shop.
Well, that's right. And speaking of rinky-dinks, remember that Google started as a scrappy startup, the way that it was described. And it's really grown into quite a company. But remember who else is sitting back and watching? The other big tech companies, Facebook, Amazon and Apple.
Yeah.
They're watching too. You know, the politicians used to have a very cozy relationship with what they call the Silicon Cool Kids. But now we're seeing backlash. There's basically a backlash against these big tech companies. But the tech companies are fighting back, and they're quoting a Devo song from the 80s that you probably remember, Freedom of Choice. They're basically saying there are other companies and there are other search engines available. If you don't like Google, switch it out. Go to something else. So that's going to be the defense in a lawsuit that Raul, I think, is going to take years to resolve.
Okay. Is there any way for, like, the normal Joe Schmo sitting at home right now to explain exactly what the lawsuit is really, really all about here? Because we've all been messing with these search engines. So what's happening now that's different from 5-10 years ago?
Well, nothing. And this lawsuit is a long time coming. Right. And I suppose if anything were to have changed, it would be the amount of money that Google has paid to get first billing on Apple products, on other places, to where that's the reason when you open a browser, you get Google. Yeah. And the argument is not all the companies have the money to pay to play. So it's anti-competitiveness. And like you said, there's nothing that's changed dramatically except that this lawsuit is finally getting filed. So it just seems like the pendulum has swung regarding the relationship.
And what led to that?
These companies.
What led to that pendulum swinging finally?
Well, I think there's been a lot of complaints over the last couple of years from, as you can imagine, the other companies that don't get top billing and are losing money and don't have the money to compete, to afford to compete, to be able to be the default browser every time people open something up. And so that has just been mounting. It's been building. Who knows whether some of the pandemic impact had something to do with the way this was accelerated. And I'm not going to go into the politics of it, but it is true that there was a push to have this lawsuit filed before the election, as it was. I think September 30th was the original date, but then Attorney General Barr pushed it back just a little bit. So let's just say, Raul, it's been a mix of factors that brought us to where we are today. But we are also wondering how this will impact our ability to do research.
That's what I'm going to say, because if anybody's confused about this, we're all going to Google it, and then we're going to study that. So how do you see this? How do you see this all playing out? And like you mentioned, how is it going to affect us when we just want to look something up?
Well, it's not going to affect us in the short term, which is good news. Yeah. I mean, Google plus Wikipedia. I know that you don't rely on Wikipedia. It's a place to start. But, you know, you think of the things that Americans have been used, probably all over the world, we've been used to doing to find the information quickly. So in the short term, we probably won't see any changes. Mm. But who knows? You know, a suit like this may settle. There may be compromise. There may be other ways in which we can search just as easily on other search engines. But, you know, we're very resistant to change. We've become used to doing things a certain way.
True.
So I believe that as time moves on, I mean, we'll continue to follow the story to see if, in fact, there might be easier ways to do it. But I wouldn't expect any major changes anytime soon.
I want to make a ridiculous comparison of when everybody said there was a monopoly and no competition with the cable companies and all the channels. If you wanted to be on a cable company, you had to pay the cable company. Okay, let's all cut the cord. And now look at what's happened. Well, now there's 50,000 streaming services. And guess what's going to happen in a couple years? Somebody's going to come up with something where all the streaming services are one thing and you can just, it's cable all over again. I don't know why I just said that.
That's a great prediction, Raul. Let's see if you're right. It's a good analogy.
Wendy Patrick, you know it gets me riled up. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Raul.
Okay, see you later. You know what I mean, though? Get off my lawn. Coming up on Fox 5, a local teacher making it his goal to get more students enrolled in AP and honors classes. And then what may have caused an explosion at a mini mall? Look at that, Russo. Whoa.
Where is that? Okay, so Ian Shivers calls this picture of the day Sunset by the Ocean, and he sends it in from Oceanside. Cooling, cooler, and the chance of rain coming up. The chances that'll actually happen.
You're watching the Fox 5 Morning News at 7.
7:26. Holy mackerel, look at this. Yikes. Like the camera shaking even from the blast. Video captures the moment that a strip mall explodes, literally, in Virginia. Chrissy, it's Virginia. It happened Saturday in Harrisonburg. So far, investigators have ruled out arson. They say that there was a gas leak inside a building. The damage is so extensive that officials are unable to determine the exact origin of that leak. Coming up here on Fox 5, a cool down and a potential chance of rain. Whether or not you're going to need that umbrella anytime soon, we're checking in also with Heather Lake.
Good morning. Well, we are living the life of luxury, a Rolls Royce, a Bentley, a Ferrari. What about the brand new 2021 McLaren? We're going to show all of those to you live coming up on Fox 5.
You're watching the Fox 5 Morning News at 7.
Very serious conversation going on right now before we came back where I asked, is there still coffee in the pot? And they said, no.
Can I make a...
Oh, no, no,
may
no.
May I make a recommendation, Mr. No. Russo, before we move on? No, you can make coffee yourself at home and put it in a container that stays nice and warm so you don't have to depend on anybody for coffee.
If I may.
Okay.
I wake up. I have my Nespresso, I warm up my milk, I warm up my two pods of coffee, which I do recycle to everybody
two.
Get off my back.
Okay.
I get it in a night, and here's the thing. I require coffee so that by the time I get to work, I drink it all. So usually right around between between 7 and 7:30, I require like black coffee, like a cup of normal, like American coffee, black coffee, in addition to my two shots of espresso from earlier in the morning.
And your response, Charlie?
Anything else?
Chrissy Russo's here with our forecast.
Wait, no, I have more. No, I have more. Because, you know, I don't know if I said it on TV yesterday, but I had some coffee at home that I was going to bring in. And
did
I looked,
you?
Well, I don't know if it was on TV or off TV, but I looked at it and it had just expired.
Technically, that's fine.
I didn't bring it. You want me to still bring it in? I can bring it in tomorrow, but it expired on October 10th.
That's fine.
Okay.
October 10th. Like, coffee's going to know it expired 10 days ago. It's fine.
I'm just trying to get rid of it. We don't drink coffee in my house. I just want to get it out of the house, do some positive.
I will be refilling with the black coffee. So imagine what that's going to be like for the next couple hours.
So, kids, this is how you spike and drop your blood sugar. All this caffeine, right? That's why you wanted some coffee. You have it at like 5, and then you need it again at like 7:30, right? Because you're, you know.
Correct.
Yep.
Because I'm crashing.
Water works, kids.
I'm drinking water now.
Oh. I don't. 67 degrees in Oceanside. 69 degrees in... 69 degrees downtown San Diego, 67 degrees in Chula Vista, 62 in El Cajon. A cool, cloudy day today, 70 along the coast, mid to low 70s inland. Bring it on. All right, traffic, the southbound 15 right there at Via Rancho Parkway. Oh, it looks like they just cleared it. So a multi-vehicle crash now clear on the southbound 15 Via Rancho Parkway. Commuter Carl is headed northbound on the 5, getting up to Genesee, the 52. And everybody's moving along just fine there. There's no major crashes to report. Everybody's moving along just fine. Charlie, over to you.
Chrissy, thank you. In these uncertain times, our teachers are more important than ever. And this week, we are meeting with the best San Diego has to offer. Here is the moment that Jay Tweet learned he was named one of the county's Teachers of the Year.
Awesome.
How cool is that? Yeah. Oh, thank you very much. This is amazing.
Mr. Jay Tweet, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
How
it's been quite a wild ride.
Yeah, I'm sure. This is so exciting for you. What school do you teach at?
I teach at El Capitan High School out in Lakeside.
Out in Lakeside. And you teach history and social sciences, right?
Yeah, right now it's AP Economics and Honors Government.
Oh, that's like I think those are the classes that I probably paid the least amount of attention to in school.
I won't hold it against you.
No, please don't. Please don't. If I could go back and do things differently, my goodness, I would do it so differently. But congratulations to you. We've met a few
Thank you.
Teachers this week. What was that moment like for you to be recognized for all that you're doing to change these kids' lives?
You know, it's... When it first kind of, you first find out, you're not really expecting it. And so it's just kind of like you're in shock. And then it kind of sinks in over the next few days that, you know, you're a representative for, you know, tens of thousands of teachers in the area. And especially this year, when you know how hard everyone is working, it's just, you feel the weight, it reaches on your shoulders and it becomes a really humbling experience.
If I was not a news broadcaster, journalist, anchor person, I tell you my dream job would be to be a teacher like you. And I hear that you used to be in finance and then you changed career paths to do this. Was that same calling that you're just like, I gotta go do this?
Yeah, it was, in college, sorry, I'm on campus
bell.
Right now. In college, I had the opportunity to be a TA for a class, and I loved the teaching aspect of it. I went into finance, and I found myself in I thought was going to be a great opportunity for me, but I was being asked to do things that I just felt were kind of unethical, and I decided that I wanted to go follow what it is that I love, and I wanted a job that I would feel good about when I get home every day. So.
You talk about
went back
feeling
to school
good.
To be a teacher.
I hear that you tell your students that being a teacher is no different than being a personal trainer. How is that?
Well, it begins with like getting the students to understand that their brain is like a muscle and their job is to work out that muscle. It's teaching is not about filling a bucket. It's about getting the students to be active learners. So many students, but you know, they, by the time I see them as seniors in high school, they're really passive. They want you to tell them things. Mm-hmm. They want you to give them the answers. But it's not my job to be here learning. It's their job to be here learning, my job teaching. So just like a personal trainer, I can show them how to grow that brain of theirs. I can show them the exercises to make themselves smarter and stronger, but they have to do the work. If they don't do it, then they're not going to see any changes. They're not going to see any growth. You know, it's like as a personal trainer, I can show you how to do the exercises. We can talk about your goals. I can set a program with you, motivate you to get there. But at the end of the day, if you're not going to the gym and if you're not doing the work, you're not going to see changes.
I know that you're really motivated to get these kids to not only just do, right, what they show up to do and do the basics, but you really push them to take those AP and those honor classes. How do you do that? Because, I mean, at that age, what grade levels you teach again?
11th and 12th grade.
Oh, man, at 11th and 12th grade, I don't want to tell you what I was doing in 11th and 12th grade. Last thing, a lot of kids, because you're just worried about growing up. And then the opportunity to be able to take those AP classes and those honor classes, which are obviously so important nowadays to even get into some good colleges. How do you get those kids to focus and want to do that rather than be forced to do that?
You know, a big part of it comes with identifying the students that have the capabilities to do it, but haven't had the opportunity. And you know, that it's started years ago at El Capitan. You know, we noticed that we had some really great AP, you know, tough classes for the, to challenge the students, but that we had, you know, our students of color were way underrepresented in those classes, that boys were way underrepresented in those classes. And as someone who taught the regular classes, I was seeing, you know, kids that were the, some of the brightest kids on campus never challenging themselves mm-hmm. with the tough class. And so it really begins with that connection with the student and learning those students individually and then giving them that challenge and then supporting them when they get there. So I, at my site for years, administration has been very supportive with giving us money to do extra tutorials with those students so that we can support them when they struggle.
You also co-founded a triple immersion high school program. What is that?
So, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, one of my colleagues, Kelly Logan, who's like my work partner in crime, she came to me and she was like, you know, hey, my kid just started kindergarten, you know, in Lakeside School District, and they're doing this triple immersion thing with the really little kids. And she was like, when my kid gets to high school, what's he gonna do? Because there is no triple immersion high school for them to go to. So she and I went in and we met with the principal and we said, what are we gonna do for these kids when they start showing up in a few years? Mm-hmm. And we, you know, roped in some other teachers on our campus and together we thought about the problem. Now, the issue is how do you have it so that kids can take classes in three different languages and still meet all the graduation requirements for the state and the district? There's a lot of red tape there. And so it took some creative thinking and it took us working together as a team. And we were able to develop, like, you know, we tried to find other triple immersion programs in the state. And it's just, it's so hard to do mm-hmm. that there's just not many others that we could base our program on, even nationally. But we were able to figure it out. So it was, you know, something that's pretty cool.
Well, in just these few minutes, I think it's clear as day to me and probably everybody watching right now why you won this award. Congratulations to you. You can see Jay and the rest of the teachers. They're going to all be honored on November 21st, and this special ceremony airs on Your View Network. Congratulations to you. Amazing teacher.
Thank you. Thanks, Sholly.
You're welcome. Have a good day.
You too. Bye-bye.
740 now. Car dealers are debuting their 2021 models, and some of them are pretty impressive. Heather Lake is live in La Jolla this morning with a look at one of the fastest on the market. Oh,
a girl can dream. A girl can dream.
Wow.
That's all I have to say. So I'm actually going to show you some of the older ones right now. So this is 2020, right? There's still some good things that came out of 2020. We've got a Lamborghini. We've got a McLaren. We've got a Bentley, a Rolls Royce. And I have sat in all of them and enjoyed them for, you know, the moments that I can. Because if you're going to pull out the wallet and buy one of these, well, it's not going to be my wallet.
Ogara car dealership. This is in San Diego, right in La Jolla, and you basically can make an appointment right now during the pandemic and still come and see these cars. Maybe this is what you're looking for. Maybe you want to make 2020 that much better and sit in one of these cars. Well, we're going to make today a little bit better because we are debuting the brand new 2021 McLaren. And let me tell you, it is fast. Top speeds, what, 205 miles an hour?
Yeah.
Montana, tell us about it. You are the McLaren brand ambassador manager of these beautiful vehicles. So tell us a little bit about the top speeds. By the way, this is a beautiful vehicle.
Thank you. It is. It's the new McLaren 765 LT. It's based off of the prior 720S. It's a bi-turbo V8, full carbon fiber chassis, hits 205 miles an hour, 0 to 60 in like 2.7 seconds, 0 to 120 in like 12 seconds. It's unbelievable.
If someone's driving this on the road, I mean, mm-hmm. you just turn heads, right? You're the kind of person that gets to take some of these out, test drive them, see what it's like. What is it like driving one of these on the highway? It's street legal, and you can go up to 200 miles an hour.
I mean, it's one of those cars that you can comfortably go way over the speed limit, look down and realize I should probably slow down. Turns everybody's heads. Kids love it. They go crazy. It looks like a UFO. It's definitely a special car.
Yeah. So who's into this? Who's, because you said this is just, is it a prototype or what would you call this?
Yeah, this one's a pre-production model of the vehicle that will be coming out. It's already all pre-sold. You get a ton of people, car collectors, gearheads, people who track the cars, a wide range of clients will buy the 765.
You have a waiting list for this car.
Yeah, yeah.
How long is the waiting list?
We have about 25 people trying to buy the car, trying to find an allocation for them.
That's crazy. I want to see it. So I know these doors, that's kind of cool. I love to see them, like the dramatic effect of them opening and closing. So basically, pretty normal close, but then to open, you hit this kind of like, it's like a sensory spot.
Yeah, there's a little
back
pad.
Here. Yeah.
Pull up on it.
And then voila. Is it cozy? Is it a cozy ride inside?
It's a comfortable
car. Or
you
just feel all the, I mean, it's like a race car.
Yeah, so it's got full carbon fiber track seats.
I'm going to give
it a try. So getting in and out's not the easiest, but once you're in, it's a very comfortable seat.
I could get used to this. I know we told Raul that he wanted to hear the engine purr. Is this loud? I'm going to guess.
Yeah, sounds good. Go ahead and start it.
Okay. So go ahead and start it.
It's all you.
Listen, obviously, if you don't know how to start the car, if you don't know how to open the car, you can't afford the car. Am I right? Okay. So
yeah, push down
I'm like
on the
so
brake,
scared. Okay.
And then push and hold the red button.
Okay. Press the red button.
You got it?
You told me I could press it. Oh boy. Oh buddy, where's Raul? He wanted to hear this.
He's not here, but I'm sure he's jumping up and down wherever
he is right
now.
We're waking up the neighborhood.
That sounds fast.
Up the neighborhood and I'm getting out of here. This is mine.
Oh, is it?
They said I can borrow it for a few days.
You're looking good in it, Heather. Looking good. Thank you. UC San Diego is celebrating homecoming all week, and more than 20 virtual events are happening. That includes the 24th annual Triton 5K. It's the Sunday. You can walk, run, even bike your miles anywhere. All the money raised goes to student scholarships. To register, go to the Fox 5 San Diego website, click the Scene On tab. Still to come, honoring our veterans, how the Navajo Code Talkers helped American troops during World War II.
You're watching the Fox 5 Morning News at 7.
Good morning. It is 7:47 on a Thursday morning. A little overcast. This is a live look from the SDCCU.com camera. There's downtown San Diego off in the distance. Listen to this. A Norwegian official is apologizing. I'm sorry. For making 2020 a little bit longer. Norway's Minister of Trade and Industry gave the message when talking about the country's upcoming daylight saving time. She said, as the Minister of Time, she regrets adding an extra hour to an already demanding year for many. However, the official encouraged people to look on the bright side, saying, sunnier mornings are on the horizon. Yeah, the sun will come out tomorrow, right? Somebody said that once. The Rays evened up the World Series with the Dodgers last night. Now, both teams have today off. Game 3 is scheduled for tomorrow in Arlington, Texas. Walker Buehler will start for the Dodgers. Charlie Morton goes for the Rays. Our coverage begins at 4:30 right here on Fox 5. And Fox 5 is honoring veterans in a very special way this year. We'll be highlighting them in special stories over the next month as part of our Veterans Voices series. We begin now with David Romero and the story of the Code Talkers of the Navajo Nation who helped turn the tide during World War II.
The greatest thing was sacrificing our lives for our country. It wasn't just a duty, it was a responsibility. And we knew that we had to defeat the enemy, or they would defeat all of us. Take what we had.
Roy Hawthorne and more than 400 fellow co-talkers volunteered from both sides of the state border inside the Navajo Nation of New Mexico and Arizona. The idea to use the Navajo language as a communications code in the Pacific Theater came from a military man who once lived on the reservation. Young Navajo men were recruited, and this was to create the code, use common names in their language to describe military terms like battleships, tanks, and reconnaissance planes.
It's quiet, doesn't carry any armament. That's a hummingbird. In Navajo, it was Dakitin.
In battles across the Pacific, co-talkers would relay thousands of messages with no errors, and their code would never be broken by the Japanese. Hawthorne and the others had used their language as a successful weapon, though the role of the co-talkers in the war was kept secret for decades. Only much later were they acknowledged and their story fully told.
We were loyal to our country. It wasn't because it was called America, but it was called a people that were willing to do for other people. That's the way we treated one another.
Roy Hawthorne passed away in 2018. Very few of the original 400 co-talkers are alive today. For Veterans Voices, I'm David Romero.
And you will hear more about that story and others during our Veterans Voices Honoring Our Heroes show that airs later this month. Fox 5 News special. It debuts on Halloween night at 9 o'clock. Still to come here on Fox 5, how a man ended up splitting a lottery jackpot with himself. And how much time it took a woman who is 9 months pregnant to run a mile. And we want to say good morning to Mark and Jeannie from Poway. They are the Fox 5 Friends of the Day, presented by Jerome's. They like being, listen to this, they like being in love for 26 years. And they also love playing golf. If you want to be our Friend of the Day, go to our website. You could win a gift card to Jerome's Furniture, where all showrooms are open.
No time for a summer friend. No time for the love you send. Seasons change and so did I. You need.
You're watching the Fox 5 Morning News at 7.
A man wins $3.8 million because he won the lottery twice on the same drawing. The Canadian man said he accidentally bought two tickets instead of one last month, and it turns out both tickets had the same numbers, and they both won. According to the rule, he actually has to split the jackpot with himself. Must be nice. Coming up, a 104-year-old man celebrates his birthday with a joyride in his car, plus the House of Horrors that is making head spin in Southern California. We're also checking in with Eric Richards.
And good morning to you. County officials right now stressing the importance of getting that flu shot amid the ongoing pandemic. We'll have more in a news conference happening in a couple hours.
Good morning, I'm Shali Zamarodi. Supreme Court nominee Amy Coney Barrett now headed to a full vote.
I'm Raul Martinez. U.S. officials warning of new attempts to interfere in the election.
Free flu shots. Good morning, I'm Eric Richards in Kearney Mesa. Why county officials hope you take advantage of this opportunity.
Cooler day on the way. Good morning, I'm Chrissy Russo. Coming up, the chance we could get some weekend rain.
Good morning, I'm Heather Lake, headed to Del Mar. We're talking about a Halloween shopping experience and a costume contest where you can win some